We now start the session, the CEO session. Kiran is slightly delayed, and therefore, Mr. Pai, request you to please come to moderate the session. We invite Mr. Sandeep Maini, Mr. Varun Berry, Mr. Krishna Kumar Natarajan, Mr. Pai, please, and of course, Mr. M.N. Reddy, our commissioner, to please come on stage for this session. Ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome to all the CEOs on stage for the CEO sessions in conversation with Mr. Pai. Please do come.
Folks, we'll start with a short round of introduction. Krishna Kumar.
I'm the CEO and Managing Director of Mindtree, and clearly very passionate about this area because I certainly have views, while Mohan rightly said in terms of trying to enforce rights, I think there needs to be change which gets driven at a far more grassroots level, because I think to really sustain a change, I think it's important to start thinking of what the fundamental issues are and then try and start addressing them. I'll try and share some of my perspectives on that.
Yeah, my name is Varun Berry. I'm the Managing Director of Britannia. Again, very passionate about this. I think there's no compromise on this topic. Very clearly, this is a cultural issue which needs to be addressed at the grassroots. And that's what this group and everyone in this country needs to do.
Good morning all, I'm Sandeep Maini, the chairman of the Maini Group. Most people have been talking about how passionate they are, what's required to be done. I'm really passionate about how do we create awareness, how do we create holistic awareness across all sections of society and all sections of age group. So look forward to sharing some thoughts during this session. Thank you.
Good morning ladies and gentlemen, I'm M.N. Reddy, the police commissioner. It's my duty to be passionate about this subject. I really have no choice. Now that's in a lighter vein. We are conscious, and I believe that we are constantly sensitizing our own forces down the line to become more sensitive. There's no limit to being in terms of being sensitive, because there is a very deep problem that we face in the society. It's very entrenched in almost in the DNA of the people around. Therefore, it's going to take a while. But as far as the processes, the systems, the very thought process of, you know, very intent is all there. And I assure you that as we go forward, I think we'll dwell a few on a few issues of this nature. I'm very thankful for having been invited for this session.
I'm Mohan Das Pai, Vice President of BPAC. I'll start this session by asking Krishna Kumar. Now, Krishna Kumar, in 1999, you know, the Vishakha case had come from the Supreme Court. Now we are in 2015. How have you seen an improvement in the workplace, in your company and in the companies that you know and in general industry, about prevention of harassment in the workplace, especially for women? Have you seen a change in the attitudes of companies? Have you seen better processes? Have you seen an increase in the confidence of women? And where do you think the gaps are?
See, let me treat it differently. While I think the Vishakha case really gave the framework, and being a part of NASSCOM, I think we ran an audit in terms of how IT companies are really complying with it. Clearly, a lot of companies looked at it primarily as a compliance vehicle, which means it's left to somebody to really check the boxes in terms of saying, okay, when there's a women employee leaving after 8 p.m., is there a guard accompanying them and so on. But to me, that's really just one piece of just looking at it from a compliance angle. I think what needs to first get established is an enabling condition where have we created an environment we aspire to be something. Because clearly in our current work context, I think I'm fairly loud enough. In our work context, I think many times, I do see a lot of very capable women professionals sacrificing part of their aspiration because they believe that's
that is really the right thing to do in the context of work. So first of all, I think companies need to change the mindset in terms of saying, are you really allowing your women professionals to really aspire what they want to do? And then, how are you really doing grassroots level interventions to really change sensitivities of people? Interestingly, many times I observe it could really be reflected in very basic things. In fact, I find in my office, when people are waiting for an elevator and the elevator door opens, a lot of male colleagues rush in even without making the basic offer, which are fundamental sensitivities which you need to do, including, I'm sure, Mohan, I know you have been a great proponent of that. In the IT industry, there are project managers who want to de-roster a woman colleague because she's pregnant. How do leaders walk the talk and say, these are completely unacceptable? I think that's the key thing. So I see two things which organizations need to do. Don't look at these things just as compliance-led, but how are you changing basic elements of how people are really getting institutionalizing the change? And second thing is, how are really leaders walking the talk? I think those two aspects, I think, are very important.
Varun, you've been a business leader for a pretty long period of time. You've worked in different industries. What is your view on this? Do you see, what has been your experience as regards this matter?
Yeah, so I must tell you that I've seen a dramatic change in attitude of people, a very positive change in companies that I've worked in. I was with PepsiCo for 19 years, and I saw that PepsiCo as a whole, not just in India, but PepsiCo overall had taken great steps to make sure that there was complete safety, security of women in workplace. I'm seeing a very serious change in Britannia, the way the way people are looking at this and the sensitivity to this. I think the issue really, as I see it, the onus is completely on us. The onus is not just on us from a workplace standpoint, but the onus is also on us from how we bring up our children, what we breed into our children's minds. I think it's a cultural thread which needs to be strengthened. I think Mr. Reddy was saying, it will take time. But I think it's been now a lot of years that we've been struggling with this issue. And I think we have to have a situation of no compromise.
Zero tolerance.
Zero tolerance, no compromise. Things are moving in the right direction, but that's not good enough. It has to move to 100%, a 70%, a 80%, a 90%, even a 99% is not acceptable. So I think a zero tolerance, no compromise attitude has to be bred into the organizations that we work in.
Sandeep, your views on this.
Sure, I'd like to just take a little different perspective. We were a small and medium-scale company. Most of our employees were on the shop floor, and we started taking very few women slowly over time. But I want to just show you the shift in what's happened over the last 20 years. When I used to interview an engineer who was married and coming into work, one of the many questions that I used to ask him is your wife working? Have you allowed her to work? And the answer I used to get, most often than not, is no. Today, when I ask that question, I find more than 50% saying, yes, they are working. This fills my heart with pride to say that there's a change. And I move against the thing that education could be the core behind why we are talking about women's safety, etc. Is it because of lack of education? Or is it because of lack of awareness? I personally feel it's because of lack of awareness. Because 20 years ago, everyone was very much educated in our society, and they still felt that this is how they should run their families and life. Whereas today, that's not the case. So where are we in this state, in addition to what my other colleagues have said? What are we doing about awareness? Who are we talking to? We are all mothers, sisters, family members over here. When do you all think
is the right time to touch a sensitive issue like we are discussing today with your daughters or have a discussion with your mothers? When is this done? I can put my hand on my heart and say that people, even in our educated society, hesitate to touch this topic till a question is asked by your daughter about it. So my strong view is that all of us must get together and find out which are the levels of awareness we must create, how we must do it, and what actions we must do to make sure this awareness goes down to the grassroots levels across all sections of society. Communication has been a challenge across all sections of society all the time. Parents do not know when they want to start talking to their children about certain sensitive issues. We are a sensitive society. We are an emotional society. So we rather take the easy way out by not talking and letting things flow. I think it's high time we started talking, and you said that in your speech, Mohandas, that we must start talking. And I feel communication and awareness are the two key issues that we must see how we can take this forward. Thank you.
Sir, you are the commissioner of Bangalore City, responsible for the safety and enforcement of law for 1 crore Bangaloreans. All of us come under your jurisdiction. Now, as regards women and children in our city of Bangalore, there have been multiple incidents in the past, and there is a sense of fear amongst women, especially working women. After dark, there's a sense of fear in walking on the street to go to the public transportation. There are multiple chain snatching incidents. The auto rickshaw drivers in the evening don't want to take you home, and many of them are thugs who try to harm you, take more money from you. And if people approach the police, sometimes women feel that the police will not protect them. Women are scared to go to the police station because they feel if they go to the police station, they're going to be at the receiving end, and the police are not trained. You are a very compassionate commissioner. You've done many, many things. Can you tell us what is your view on making Bangalore a safe city for our children and women, where women will walk safely on the streets, go about their business without any fear, where if something happens to them, they will be rescued and there will be immediate action, and the police will be sensitive and respond to their safety needs?
Anyone ready to answer this question? Mohan is an HR guy, so he knows how to interview people. Has been an HR guy. Mohan, what you mentioned is all very correct. And if I were to sit here and say that all is well, then I'll be pushing everything under the carpet. I wouldn't be actually doing exactly what you said. We should talk. I think we look at security or security providing security as a part of the overall system. It's only a subsystem. While you might say that, you know, we all come under your jurisdiction, very many times I don't feel that. I feel when you go deeper into an issue, I mean, sometimes you lose the larger canvas out of it, and you're going, you know, searching for some particular thing, particular incident, particular event, etc. But if you look at it, if you take a larger view, I would say that last six, eight months, there have been some incidents, women and pertaining to women as well as children, particularly girl child, the schools, etc. And it was a huge challenge for the police and the administration to deal with it. Now, one aspect I need to bring to your notice is that there is there's incidence of crime, then there is perception about the incidence of crime. I'm not trying to say that by saying that perception sometimes is disproportionately higher than the crime itself, I'm not trying to score a brownie point. All that I'm trying to say is that they need not necessarily be the same. So therefore, if you ask me today what's your number one responsibility as police commissioner, I'll say dealing with the perception about crime. Because crime, we do. I mean, that's a bread and butter. We need to deal with it. We do it. and we need to improve, we need to move on ways, and we can come to that. But it's the sense of security or lack of it. And I think that's much bigger worrying problem, much more worrisome problem than crime itself, I would say. Because it sends a kind of a feeling of unease in the community at large, which is what we need to. So we need to have that kind of ethical standpoint, as well as we need to have that kind of, let's say, a genuine posturing wherein you tell that, look, this much and not more, and this is it. So I want to just get that clear first, that, you know, a large-scale enemy doesn't exist in Bangalore. It's not an anemic society where there's no norms, there's normlessness. Not like that. Well, no society is like that, frankly, except a few parts of the world. But I would say that Bangalore as a city is in the throes of change. The constitution of the population is very unique.
Very unique.
Very unique. We have probably the maximum number of immigrant, fresh arrivals in Bangalore, those who work, those been here for 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, etc. And there's a whole lot of churning that's taking place. The expectations are far higher than what would be, say, in another part of the world, country. You know, the expectations from the citizens. Therefore,
I think we are higher expectations than, say, Delhi or Bombay?
I would say that at least part of Bangalore has got international expectations about what's happening in our local area. And why not? I mean, there's nothing wrong. So I get a lot of tweets like, you know, say, Mr. Commissioner, it's already 2 hours since I sent you the message. Nothing has happened.
But at least you're the only police commissioner on Twitter. And you respond.
Yeah, I believe that by opening up, you're actually telling that we're available, we're accessible, and maybe we're not perfect, but we're not that bad either. So I think that has helped us. That has helped particularly with this set of people who are more savvy on internet, on Twitter, etc. So coming back to the larger issue I would say is that I think we have somehow waded and kind of managed to get perception back in some sort of a control, I would say that. I mean, that's my personal or, let's say, professionally individual opinion, but then it can be contested by anybody.
Second, are you saying that citizens of Bangalore, especially women, feel safer now than they felt some time ago?
No, there were episodes which really kind of raised a lot of questions, and then which, you know, in young working mothers who leave their children in school, in creche, etc., and, you know, that sense of what will happen to my child, that kind of thing that really kind of became so big, I think that has been contained. And access that we want to create and we continue to create, I think is a thing that is, I have a larger Twitter followers from young women who are working. And they do mention a lot of things. You know, I tried crossing the road, I am this guy misbehaved, and this happened. All sorts of things, all sorts of day-to-day incidents are brought to our notice. And it's a good way of getting to interface with them. And I think we're doing it. We're growing 500 a day. I think we will soon reach 100,000 in about few months, 3-4 months time. And we have already got about a 400,000 followership on our Facebooks. So together we're about 500,000. I think it's a very good thing. So we will be accessible to start with. Then the moment you're accessible, the thing about social media is that everybody knows everything about what is written in all these things. So, I mean, it puts you some kind of a social stigma if you don't respond, or if you don't do what you promise you will, what you say that you will do. So it's a very good self-correcting mechanism, which is good, and we will go ahead with it. That's one dimension I wanted to mention. Then as far as, you know, the day-to-day, the underbelly of what happens, you know, like just a small thing, somebody is walking, somebody is passing a comment, somebody traveling the bus, somebody misbehaves, an auto rickshaw driver refusing to take you or, you know, giving you a look that is not very charitable, for want of a better word. These are things, I think these are deeper matters. These are deeper, these require, like the theory of the broken windows, I think these are the broken windows. These are the broken windows of our society, and trust me, I mean, you put somebody as police commissioner and say that, what have we done? I mean, it's very tough. We have got to work consistently on it. For, let's say, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, we can bring about that change. The traffic chaos, or let's say, traffic indiscipline actually spreads to other parts of the lives as well. The people who violate traffic rules are also going to be prone to violating other things as well in life, right? So they could get into brawls, they could get into road rage is just another expression of this mentality. So these are, so I think we need to go to a very grassroots level of enforcement. Now this is where we are trying to do a few things. One, we are trying to redo the, there is a grassroots level enforcement law called the Karnataka Police Act. Now Karnataka Police Act is like Indian Police Act or any other state has got a police act, which is for the normal day-to-day things, nuisance, public nuisance, you know, petty crimes, which we all think are petty crimes, and police over a period of time have moved away from petty crimes. And they are more concerned about murders, etc., etc. But I think those petty crimes are the ones which are actually the breeding ground, or that's the level at which things are breeding. And that's what pops up into a big crime, and you're so busy with big crimes that you're not able to go beneath. So I think the coming period, coming era in policing will be that you need to go deeper. So we have sent a huge rehashing of the Karnataka Police Act, written in 1960, and the fine is 25 rupees, 50 rupees, etc. Like as poor as our traffic fines used to be a few years ago. So we have said 1,000 rupees, 5,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees. We need to really go bang at that grassroots level enforcement. And I think once we start doing that, a lot will fall in place. And that is where I see the whole set of women's safety, because these are mobile, educated, working women who are out, who have to be out on the streets, not by choice, but by profession, but by requirement of our job. And they're mobile, they're educated, going to colleges, schools, they're going to workplaces, maybe leisure. So they're out there, and this mismatch, if I can use the word, or this the fact that our society at that level is yet not prepared for taking them along with due respect that they deserve is one thing that we need to deal with. I think it's going to take a while. But I think at least we have the perspective clear.
Thank you, sir. Now, KK, we are where we are today. What do you think should be the roadmap for industry in the next 3 years, I don't take 5 years, to make sure at the end of these 3 years, we stamp out or we have a zero tolerance policy everywhere against harassment of women in the workplace? And the message is very clear that whatever happens is an aberration and women will be protected and there is no debate about that. What are the things we should do in industry in the next 3 years?
See, clearly I don't think the industry should look at the government to create a compliance environment to do it. I think the responsibility squarely rests with individual companies themselves, because first of all is the onus of accepting responsibility, saying that this is a problem within my environment, I am clearly committed to solve it. Create an operating framework where people have the ability to sort of, one, sensitivize, which is the education part of it. Like all my co-panelists said, yes, it is a long process. But how do you really create that enabling environment, make it an institutional priority to create that awareness and ensure that people are living by that sort of thing, which really starts with the top management and the leadership. If they don't walk the talk and articulate that, I think never any change really happens. Then clearly making very visible things where there is a deviation, absolutely publicizing that in terms of demonstrating zero tolerance and publicizing it, because I think that's where I think the message really gets in hard and clear. And the last element is, I think, really creating the right forums within the organization for women employees to feel free to talk about it, to articulate their aspirations, and see that the organization really thinks of it as an enabling environment, and safety is a very important part of it, where people believe, yes, it is happening, and I'm confident. And how do you really do that litmus test very frequently? Maybe every 6 months, check with people, are you satisfied with the progress? And have the ability to articulate and go public with that, saying, we were here at this goalpost, we have moved here, this is what we need to do. I think it is absolutely possible for the organization to do it. It is for people to take onus, rather than trying to say, the police commissioner hasn't done it, the government hasn't done it.
Now, KK, you are a very eminent citizen of Bangalore, and you are a leader. People see you clearly as a leader. Two questions. The first is, how will you as a leader make sure that the ecosystem of industry, not your company, because you are a very evolved person, your company is doing very good work. How will you as a leader stand up for women safety and make sure that the ecosystem responds to it and puts in place processes, and what are you going to do personally about it? And second, for the larger issue of safety of women and children in a society, how will you as a leader work to make Bangalore a better place in terms of safety for women and children? Two questions.
I think great questions, Bon. See, what you started doing in terms of how to do it is, we started about a year back in NASSCOM in terms of best practices in safety, and now we have covered a number of organizations within thing itself, because I think there are very simple elements. When I talked about saying compliance to doing what is right, yes, there is a compliance issue in terms of saying when a woman lives after 8 p.m., if she's getting dropped, a guard has been accompanied. But have we educated those drivers to be sensitive to women employees? Have we got a list in terms of how many things? Are you pushing your vendors to do that, and you select the right vendors who have people who have those sensitivities? Is very important. We are trying to share a lot of those best practices. Clearly, I think with the Diversity Inclusivity Council of NASSCOM, which is very active, I think there is progress, but to be honest, I personally feel the progress has been slow. I think it needs to move at a much, much faster pace. What I do believe as an individual, what I can do is, clearly many times we try and boil the ocean. So what we have started trying doing is taking a location which is close by to our offices and really educating people within that, saying that this is what as an organization, the support we'll provide in that. So if each one of us start adopting a ward out of probably the 140 wards in Bangalore, I think in 12 months time, we'll be able to get substantive public awareness, larger commitment, and clearly a visible change.
Thank you. Varun, same three questions. First is about 3 years, then you as a leader for your business and your ecosystem and for society.
Yeah, so I think I absolutely agree with KK. The standard operating procedures have to be absolutely clear. Everyone, the education within the company has to be absolutely clear. Everyone in the organization has to be clear that what needs to be done in case something like this happens. The women in the organization should know that they have the ear of whoever they want in the organization, without any risk of any repercussion against them on any factor that may come up during that conversation. I think making sure that there's progress, making sure that sharing of information happens, making sure that it's not just your organization, but it's the organization as a whole, people that you work with. There are vendors, there are contract packers. So just to give you an idea, the number of employees in Britannia is fairly low. But the multiplication factor of, if you look at all the distributors we have, all the contract packers that we have, all the vendors that work for us, is the multiplication factor is 1:35.
Right? So will you insist all of them follow the same code?
So we are moving towards that. We are moving in stages. We are moving from our organization to the largest contract packers and the larger vendors, but we will make sure that in the next 3 years we move through that entire population of the entire organization. right? And we take charge of that, and we make sure that we insist that you know, the standard operating procedures are, you know, are employed by all of these organizations that work with us. I think the other thing that I'm very passionate about is it's not just about what happens in the organization. Our employees start from home and get to office and finish work and get back home, right? It's very important that the entire process, you know, when they leave home to when they get home, covers, you know, is covered by, you know, how we can help them. And I do think that there is a lot that all of us can contribute as leaders to how to improve the infrastructure, to help Mr. Reddy on how we can improve infrastructure in Bangalore. I do think that there are a lot of things that need to be done. You know, simple infrastructure like cameras, making sure that, you know, people are aware that whatever they do is not going unnoticed. You know, all that needs to be done. And I think as corporate citizens and corporate leaders, it's our responsibility to engage with the government, engage with the police, in making sure that we get the infrastructure right. The traffic, you know, the kind of, you know, the buses, the kind of crowds that there are in buses, all that. You know, we've just moved, and I must share this with you. We were on Old Airport Road, and we've just moved to Whitefield. And, you know, after a week, I had about 25 women in the organization coming to me and saying that, you know, it took them 3 hours to get to office. Think about women who are taking 3 hours to get to office and 3 hours to get back to office. They are changing 3 buses, you know, some of them are taking trains, and, you know, infrastructure, all that, you think about it. It is not a position that, you know, we as corporate leaders should be, you know, avoiding or not thinking of, because this is the life of our employee. We have to think about the life of our employee through and through, not just in office, but even from the time they leave home and from to the time that they get home. So I think we need to work with whichever agency to make sure that we are able to improve these conditions, we are able to get to the infrastructure that's required, we are able to get to the situation in the city to be genuinely safe. By having,
and you are willing to lead in future. You commit yourself to making sure personally that you spend some time on this.
Absolutely. It's very important that we do it, all of us get into this and do it as a group and work towards making this city into a much better city than what it is today.
Sandeep, same 3 questions.
Sure. I will just add to what both of them have said without repeating. And I think the key thing is that we know what's going wrong. We know why it's going wrong. The challenge we all face today is how are we going to correct it? And the how factor becomes very important. You know, in our board meetings today, and all of you have been part of board meetings, you know, how is the agenda set? The agenda is always set with objectives which are quantifiable objectives. So we talk about business plans, we talk about profits, etc. And then when we have time, we talk about miscellaneous items. Today, in most of our board meetings, large or small, and I've been part of many boards, small and large, this aspect that we are just talking about comes under miscellaneous items. One of the most important things, if you want to have a top-down approach, is that what is important to your society, what is important to your employees, what is important to us in general, is a subjective topic, not objective. And that should be the number one in your board agenda to start with. So are you talking about what's happened in your company on safety? What are you doing about safety? What are the actions you have taken? Have you put this law in place? And the chairman of the board asks, I would like an update from the HR team and from my top management on this before we move on to the functions of the company. So I think there must be a dramatic change in how we address the how part of this whole thing. And only then will the company, the top management, and the employees feel that this board has started looking at us seriously. So I would suggest that this become one of the top priorities if we were to make a change. Number two, we normally, and I'm coming from the background that I am, you know, we are not in the IT sector. We have a large population that works as production associates on the workforce, more than 2,000 people. And how do we address issues that they have at their home and other places? So the number two is, how do we do this? Is, are we having sessions with our workforce or production associates to understand their mindset? For example, let's take, it's a sensitive issue, but it's important to bring it up. Let's take the video of, you know, which we've been talking about, India's Daughter. Do we show this to our people and have discussion sessions and get their views? How do we assess what is the mindset of our population of workforce? How do we assess it? Is by showing controversial topics, by showing sensitive topics, and in work hours, not outside of work hours, allowing 1 hour discussion to have the right people sitting in that audience and find out, this is the mindset of the workforce in my company. So that you can bring out pragmatic ways of resolving that mind as you go ahead. Third, how do we involve the families? In what way do we involve the families? Do you know that 60% of the companies that give awards to their production associates for various things they do, be it cash or any award, their families never know they've got the award. They never know that, because this amount of money that goes to them, right, goes straight to the liquor shop in the evening.
Celebrate.
In form of a celebration. The wives and the children never know this is happening. They are not aware of what is happening. So that awareness of including them, of getting their views, starts becoming a process of going down the line. So I believe that it's important that this conclave at the end of this session brings up the hows, which are simple brass tacks, which all of us feel are low-hanging fruit, and we must start grabbing them immediately and start doing it, which will then have a multiplier effect across. Fourth, is get evangelist companies who truly believe in this. You know, today, when you talk about anything, and I think Kiran and you are evangelists in many, many areas, you found challenges when you want to start something. When you wanted to start an ethics code, you found nobody raised their hands. So you need to find evangelists. For this, we need to find companies which are going to be evangelists. Get these evangelists out, make smaller groups of 10 companies, and start evangelizing this in a manner where we are able to tell them how to do it. What are the best practices to share? So that there's a common platform to be able to do it. So these are some of my views on this.
Will you be a leader for society? This is all about your enterprise, but we want you as a leader, an eminent member of Bangalore. Will you lead efforts in Bangalore to make our society a safer place for women and children?
Absolutely. I think the very presence that all of us are here today, and that the fact that BPAC and all of you have given us an opportunity, right, and accepting this opportunity is giving our indication that we would love to do that.
Sir, last question, then 2-3 questions from the audience when we'll wrap up this. What should we, as citizens of Bangalore, do to help you make the city safer for women and children? What are your expectations from us?
Thank you. As corporate citizens, I think I take the view of the other panelist who said that Keki, I think you mentioned about how you can look at your local area, the region, the sector of the society where you're located, and see how you can make the place safer. I must say BPAC has been very forthcoming in this, that, you know, they've worked with us. One project we're working is they're setting up cameras in all our police stations. Not outside the police stations, but inside the police stations. So that the top leadership can view, everything becomes more transparent. It's already started yielding results. I mean, I keep checking out, and I think Mohan was witness to it. So they're all smiles because they know that there are cameras. So it'll become a habit. Even if the camera conks off, you know, they wouldn't know it has conked off. So on the lighter side. But I
tell them what it is. It's very important. tell them. What it is, you know, there are three cameras in every police station, one outside, one inside. So when you go and complain and sit before the policeman, the commissioner is watching you. And maybe the commissioner will speak to him, please respond. And one next to the lockup, where it is at the entrance of the lockup, but the commissioner sitting in his office for about 104 police stations can click, find out each police station, talk to them and see what is happening, and he knows everything. There's surveillance, safety for everybody. It's happened to, I think, about 35, now we'll go to 50, hopefully another. And sponsored by various organizations in Bangalore as a civic action, so it has been done. I just wanted to explain.
Yeah. So that's a very interesting initiative that hasn't been done, as far as I know, anywhere else in the country. There was a lot of resistance internally. They said that, you know, I mean, don't you believe us and stuff. So we said, no, let's do it, even if it's going to be a big mistake, doesn't matter. We'll just do it and let's see what happens. Nothing is going to happen. All hell is not going to break loose. Heavens are not going to crumble because of that. I think people have got used to it. They know that it's a new way of life. I think that has had some good result. That is one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it, I would strongly urge that the city of Bangalore being so big, I do not think that just the government alone can handle all the safety infrastructure, the required infrastructure. Now, what we are looking at is on the lines of Hyderabad, we are coming up with a Public Safety Act. Now, the Public Safety Act is one where it says if any entity has a minimum of 200 footfalls a day, they'll have to set up X number of cameras of this kind of specifications. They have to be projected out in, etc. So that feed is available. We're making the places, public places, safer by doing that. I'm sure that you agree with me. And then we also need to take, been in discussions with, Kiran has been very kind on that, that we will look at a larger number of people, bigger players, whether they can come up with a larger kind of contribution to set up these cameras. So over a period of time, not only the fixed cameras, but also all the almost every mobile phone is a camera now. So it's going to be crowdsourcing will be the future, where people can show what's happening out there. Those, you know, feeds can come to the police control room and we can act. So I think that's one major way in which, and simple, but major way in which we can bring about safety. Very palpable, we can bring about.
Filing FIR, sir.
Yeah. So filing an FIR is actually the thing that police should be doing in the police stations. Okay. So I don't want to continue the next part of the sentence. Now, the job of the police is actually to say that, okay, please come and you have a problem, we'll issue an FIR to you. But that's exactly what doesn't happen in police stations. There's a lot of hesitation, a lot of resistance built in for various reasons, bad as well as not so bad. Let's say overload on the system, can I avoid this, you know, because I'll have to investigate the case. So we said, is it necessary that people have to go to police station to register cases? It's just a legacy. You know, if you look up the dictionary, what is station? Station is a place where something is stationary. And then I said, okay, police station means police is stationary, which is not a good thing. Police should be actually mobile, and they shouldn't be in one place, actually. But for the weapons, I don't think there's anything in the police station that makes you stay put in the modern day, you know, the modern day of communication and everything. So, but what we said was, okay, they're coming to the crux of it is that we said we will change the paradigm. We will allow people, we'll de-link registration from investigation. So the police stations will do investigation eventually, but registration doesn't have to necessarily be in a police station, because the guy who's investigating has a huge stake in not registering, because it's going to be overload on him, apart from many other reasons. So we said we'll have an independent system. We worked with Cisco and we came up with this interesting solution. They already had one, but we adapted it. So we started what's called the FIR kiosks. So the first one was launched in Mantri Mall. It's doing very well, for your information. It's doing extremely well. We already booked more than 200 odd cases where people can just walk in. Anyone can, any one of you, anybody can just walk in and tap a button and there you are. There's a person on the other side through telepresence who talks to you nicely because he's also under monitoring. And that's it's much easier to monitor a back-end, you know, agent than to monitor widespread number of people. So he or she speaks to you nicely and says, "What's your problem?" And then you take your document and it'll be scanned through a high definition camera, and then it comes to the back end and they generate an FIR. It gets printed right next to you on the printer. All that you need to do is staple the pages and go home. So you've got your FIR in 20 minutes flat, which has not happened as a norm in the last 150 years. I'm extremely, extremely proud and thrilled to say this, and all the other people, the luminaries who are here, they've been in part of this project, they've been advising us, I've been interacting with them, and I think it's going to be a major game changer. It will probably hike the number of cases, because that is what is the truth. And women, for example, can just walk in and register a case, whatever they would like to, and we will probably man them with women home guards across. So we are planning 25. I've already got about 20 supports.
Sponsors.
Wow. 20, including Wipro and many other companies. And I think 1 month down the line, 25 we will launch. We were thinking of 100, that was too ambitious. I didn't get so many supports. So
it'll come, sir.
Yeah,
we'll.
So once we have done that, we have really liberated.
No media, right? Andayuti?
Okay, we are liberating the people from the processes of police. The age-old processes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, one question each from this side and one from this side. And I would like women to do it. You can talk to him later. Yes, please, madam. One question and then we'll close this session because running late. Yes.
Yeah, I think a couple of potential possibilities here. You know, we are running a 25% vacancy in the city. So out of 13,000 policemen, 25% are missing. They're not there. So they're vacant. We need to recruit, we need to train, and we need to get them. Then every year, about maybe out of 13,500, 800 people will be retiring every year. So that adds. We have to find innovative ways of doing it. We have to use technology. It doesn't have to necessarily mean that everything has to be processed in the old fashion, right? Because they're going to be a large number. When you're going to go to the petty crime level, there are going to be thousands of cases. Maybe tens of thousands of cases that need to be processed. So we need to get a system in place which can be like, you know, quick redressal, mobile courts, a whole lot of things like that. Second thing is, I think Mohan has been actually actively propagating, advocating this idea that why don't we support the police with manpower that can actually take care of non-core police functions. And that relieves the police to do more core jobs. So, you know, I think security agencies, I think Mohan has been advocating that, you know, they can actually be sponsored by the companies. You know, so let's say Electronic City Police Station gets 40 men, you know, who are actually going to do, let's say, less core jobs of the police, so that they are relieved to do more core jobs. Just an example.
Okay, folks, I think one last question on this side, then we're going to close. We are run very, very late, but it's been interesting. Anybody else this side? No question this side? Okay, madam. Yes, please. Yes. No, not this side. I'm sorry. This side is over. This side. Yeah, this side. Okay, this side from the back benches. The commissioner says backbenchers. Yes, madam. Yes, madam. Sorry, we had to cut this short because we had a very interesting conversation.
Very good morning to all of you in the dais. I had two quick questions. One is, please pardon my ignorance if it's a very stupid question, but we are talking about the Sexual Harassment Prevention Act at workplace. So I don't understand. There is a CRPC, CPC, everything that covers rape or molestation. And according to me, when there's a sexual harassment or a rape, to be very specific, it happens more out of the workplace. There is a harassment that happens which is agreeable, but when we were talking about women traveling from home to office, from office back home, transit, specifically children, why are we specifically restricting this act to workplace? I mean, I see the risk more out of workplace. At least at workplace, people are educated. There is some sort of a recourse. You can talk to people, even if you don't have the guts. You can do something. You know what your defense mechanisms are. You still got chances. I'm talking about people who are outside the workplace at the very large audience, especially children. That's question one. The second question, which is linked to the first one, is in the first round, I heard all the eminent speakers talking about creating awareness. I sort of didn't still get the idea. Awareness about what? Is it awareness about the legislation being in place or the awareness about what needs to be done, what should not be done? I mean, you're talking to children. I've started talking to my child. She's 6 years old. I mean, I really don't know what to talk to her. I'm still talking to her, telling her what I can make her understand. I still am not confident about sending her out or sending her to school. So we're talking about workplace on one hand, we're talking about children on the other hand, we're talking about awareness. I still don't get the link for all the three.
Let me answer the first question. Yeah. First is, we have something called the IPC, Indian Penal Code. We have the CRPC. We have many laws civil society outside the workplace. But this law has come specifically for the workplace because there's a gap to stamp out a particular form of behavior in the workplace. So we have a general law protecting us. So that's not an issue.
So but the general law covers even people who are working at the workplace, right?
No, it covers people in the workplace too. Yes. But they wanted to make the employer responsible for certain action. And that's why this law was brought into place. Because people are very sensitive about going out and complaining to the police station that I was harassed in my workplace, blah, blah, blah. It was not happening. So they impose the duty of care on the employer. Now, as far as Varun, you want to answer this about this focus on educating people and all that?
Yeah, so what we'd said was that in the workplace, it's very important to make sure that we take full responsibility. It's very important that corporates take full responsibility, and it's not just the workplace, it's the extended workplace. And that's something that I had added, but this law is particular to the workplace. However, we as corporates would like to do exactly what you are saying. What you're saying is that you go from home, you get back home, it's a long day, it's time at the workplace, it's also time in transit. And I think at some stage, corporates have to take responsibility of that. You are right. This is a forum which is about the workplace, but there are other, points of time when parents or you feel insecure about your child. Similarly, your husband or someone else in your family feels insecure about you going to the workplace. All that has to be looked at holistically, and we absolutely agree with that. Yeah.
The awareness point.
Can I just also add to some of these comments? One is that I think every corporate today is actually focusing on gender sensitization kind of programs. I know that in our organization, we have actually conducted many workshops on gender sensitization across the board, from the lowest level to the highest level, so that people understand what is gender sensitive, what is this whole gender issue all about. So that is creating real understanding, not just awareness. Telling people what is sexual harassment, what is considered to be anti-gender. All this kind of workshops are constantly being held across various organizations, and I'm sure many, many people are doing that. The other thing is, I think schools also have to educate their own children about what is right and what is wrong. I think, in our own way, like you said, you have a six-year-old child, and it's very difficult to tell the six-year-old child what your fears are, right? But you can say things like, don't You know, like I remember when we were growing up, don't take chocolates from strangers, don't go and talk to strangers, don't let strangers touch you and hold your hand. All these kind of things are simple kind of messaging which parents need to do. So I think it's not just about corporates being responsible for everything. I think parents also have to own up a very high sense of responsibility of how they, you know, create awareness for their own children. I think equally the school administration and management have to also create the same kind of awareness or understanding with the children. And, you know, ultimately, when we want to create a safe society, it's about creating a safe mindset. I think unless there's a cultural mindset that respects women, it all starts with that. Today we have a cultural mindset that doesn't respect women. I mean, the kind of comments and criticism that we are seeing being displayed, and these flippant comments about how women dress or how women speak or how they behave, or if women go to a pub, they are this way, and we are becoming so judgmental. This is what needs to be, you know, issued in terms of, I mean, addressed in terms of the mindset. If you can change that mindset and make people understand that a woman's status in society has to be respected in terms of everything, and that's what is the fundamental problem that we're really focusing on and addressing in this country, because it starts with that. If a woman is respected, a child will be respected. What you're talking about are, you know, we've got always very fringe elements in society. Now that has to be dealt with as a criminal offense, and you know, the regulators have to really tackle that. But in general, I think we have to stop this kind of very, very wrong mindset and attitude that society has towards women. I think that's where it starts.
You want to say something?
Yeah, I think.
Just to add to what Mohan, you were saying, I'm sorry to interrupt, but because it was related with the ICC, the Internal Complaints Committee, one of the reasons was to make the employer responsible. The other is the ICC has the powers of a civil court. So it's not just, you know, any committee. It has a power. So what the government has done is it says that so many of these petty things that come up, petty or if it is larger one, if it's a rape or something like that, then a company has to support the employer in filing the court, assisting and doing all that. But the petty things, the so-called smaller ones, can be dealt with very effectively with full powers by the ICC. It doesn't have to, you know, go through the whole court. Our courts are already overloaded. So what this act has done is made small courts in every workplace, including schools and hospitals too.
Yeah, very quickly, I think Kiran alluded to that answer very well, but very quickly, you know, when we were young, the awareness of our parents was that there's a traffic safety problem. Look left and right before crossing the road. Things have changed over the last 30 years. There are many, many more things that our children have to be made aware of in terms of what technology, whether it's texting, whether it's on the Facebook, etc. And that's what I was alluding to, that as the world has moved, we as parents, educated, have a lot more things to learn and make our children aware of than when we were growing up. Just a closing comment on that.
Okay, folks, please give a standing ovation to all the people on the dais for the wonderful work. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Education, awareness, the law, all these discussions, I'm sure, will open our eyes to ensure a lot more is done in this city.